So in couple of minutes we'll start the session, sir. No problem, sir.
Sure. So we are live.
Okay. Manoj, we can start now.
Sure, sir. You can start now.
Very good morning, all. Today we have a webinar on cybersecurity system by Professor Sandeep Shukla. Professor in IIT Kanpur, and he's also heading CPI Center at IIT Kanpur. It's very honored to introduce Sandeep Shukla, sir. He's a very good friend of mine from past couple of years. Sandeep Shukla, sir, is currently a professor and head of the department in Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Kanpur. He is currently the editor-in-chief of ACM Transaction on Web Embedded Systems and associated editor for ACM Transaction on Cyber Physical Systems. Shukla sir obtained his BE degree from Jaipur University in 1991. After his graduation, he immigrated to the United States, where he attended University of Albany for 3 years, where he obtained MS degree. And he got enrolled his PhD degree, and he completed in 1997. He was a faculty at the Virginia Tech, Arlington, Virginia, between 2002 to 2015. In 2014, he was named Fellow of the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineering for his contribution towards the applied probabilistic model checking for system design. And he's also heading a center at IIT Kanpur called as Center for Cybersecurity and Cyber Defense of Critical Infrastructure. And his expertise in the domain of blockchain and cryptography also. He's having numerous contributions towards journals and papers, journals and conferences. We are very fortunate to have you on this webinar, sir. Welcome you for this webinar, sir, and I'll hand over this to Sandeep Shukla, sir.
Thank you, Raj. So just a few two corrections. I actually finished my term as head of the Department of Computer Science and Engineering on 30th April. So now we are
okay.
So I finished my term as head, and also at the same time on 1st of April, I also finished my 6 year term as the editor in chief of ACM Transactions on embedded computing system. So
congratulations, sir.
Thank you. So right now I am actually having a little more time to do my research. So having said that, for this talk, I have selected a topic that I felt that would be very interesting to everybody. So normally, a research talk involves what we do in research at IIT Kanpur in the C3I Center. And normally, we work on critical infrastructure, that is security of power system, security of water treatment plants, or Industry 4.0. And malware analysis and so on. But here, since the audience would be mostly probably students and people who are not necessarily associated with cybersecurity, so I have picked a topic that should be useful for almost everyone. And the idea is that in cybersecurity, there are multiple different facets. So one of the issue that we are worried about is our own personal cybersecurity. So we are always using smartphone, we are using our laptops, we are working remotely from home these days. We do emails, we do financial transactions online, and all these things are exposing us to various kinds of players in the cyber crime domain, who try to extract information and who try to use that information against us, sometimes doing bank fraud, sometimes creating various other issues like stalking and so on. So what I would say is that the other facets of cybersecurity is how to secure an enterprise network and enterprise system. Or another facet would be how to secure the critical infrastructure, which has implications in national security. But right now, let's focus on our own security. So what I would like to do here is that I would like to talk about threats to our privacy and security of what we possess. We possess various things. One thing is our identity, which is a very important thing that we possess. And the other is our data. Our data is very valuable. And then the our financial well-beings, that is our online transactions and so on. So these are continuously under threat. And then I will say a few words about why is it so easy for hackers? Because normally you would think that this is a high-tech crime and therefore it requires sophistication and technological know-how. But what I would like to point out is that it's not like that anymore. This hacking has been commercialized and therefore criminal gangs or nation states can actually use hacking services, payloads for various kinds of exploits directly from specific markets. And therefore it's an easy thing for anybody who wants to actually exact harm on you could actually try to do that. And then I will talk, elaborate on some good practices that you all of you should follow. That includes, starting from very simple thing like password hygiene, all the way to how to keep your home Wi-Fi router secure. So before we go into this, let me give you two stories. So these stories are slightly old, like they're probably from 2010 and so on. And this is a guy called Matt Honan, whose accounts at Amazon, Apple, Google, all were hacked together. And how were they hacked? So first of all, the attacker went to his Gmail. They knew his Gmail address, but they didn't know the password. So what they did was they used the reset password option. Now reset password in Google or any other system used to send a verification link to a backup email. It still does it, but before it does it, it might ask you some extra questions and so on. But right now, it was a verification link sent to a backup email. But before sending the email to that backup email address, Google actually prints on the screen that I am going to send you a verification link to this email address or at least part of that email address. So hacker figured out that this guy's backup address was his apple@me.com account. Okay. So now this guy is semi-famous. So it was not difficult to find his Apple email address. Now what the hacker does is it goes to the Apple account and then types in the email address and then he doesn't know the password. So he again tries to do a password reset. Now at this time, Apple password reset used to ask the billing address and last four digits of the credit card registered with Apple. Okay, so address can be easily found. We always put out our address in various forums social media, etc. And this guy was quite famous, so his address was not difficult to find. But how do you get the last four digits of his credit card, which Apple needs to reset the password? So this hacker then goes to Amazon and types in his various email address and then asks for a password. But before you want to do that, what you have to do is that you have to get somehow the password. Now Amazon at that time, it doesn't do that anymore, would allow you to register a new credit card. So in Amazon, you register a few credit cards so that later on when you want to pay, you can refer to one of the credit cards. But at that time, Amazon would allow you to register a credit card without logging into the account. You just have to say that this is my Amazon username and here is the new credit card I am loading. So the hacker goes and sends and puts in a new credit card number in the Amazon account. Now this account, this thing gets into his account. Now he goes to do the Amazon password reset. Now, when he tries to do Amazon password reset, like Apple, Amazon also requires a credit card number that is registered with Amazon. Now, just freshly, the hacker had already registered a credit card. So he uses that number to unlock the password. Once he goes into the account, he finds the other credit cards that the person had registered with Amazon, and then uses one of them one by one to see whether any of them are registered with Apple. And lo and behold, one of the credit cards that was registered in Amazon for this guy also was the one registered with Apple. So Apple he could now reset the Apple password. And once he could reset the Apple password, then he goes back and goes into Apple emails, me.com emails, finds out the backup, the link that the Google sent, and then he hacks then he resets the Gmail password. So you see that this is a iterative process, and various password reset policies used by three different organizations were used in tandem in order to hack this guy's accounts in the same time. So they were actually somehow unknowingly became collaborators with the hacker to hack this guy's Gmail, Apple and Amazon accounts. So this is, this is this complicated, that you are registered with various services. Now Gmail, Apple and Amazon have since fixed some of these problems. So therefore you probably cannot repeat this particular one for any of them. But we are members of various other organizations and other kind of e-commerce accounts. And if they are not careful, if they're not aware of this particular story, then they might have left some of these holes in their account reset, password reset system, and you can get hacked. So this is one story. The other story was American vice presidential candidate Sarah Palin in 2008. Her Yahoo email got hacked, but in that case, it was much more easy, because what happened is that Yahoo actually for password reset asks from security questions. And the security questions are usually something like, what was your high school name? What was your birthday? What was your mother's maiden name? And this kind of information. And many times these informations are very easy to find on social media for that person. And that exactly happened with Sarah Palin, and her Yahoo email account was hacked. So these are the kind of things that has been happening for a while. Now, why is it so easy to hack these days? Because the hackers do not need a whole lot of expertise. What they have to do is that they have to go to the dark web, and there are marketplaces for buying exploits. There are marketplaces for buying hacking services. So there are people and groups, they will actually do the hacking for you. And there are hidden message boards and chat rooms for hackers where you can go in and collect expertise and collect methods to hack other people. So therefore, you don't have to have a computer science degree or big knowledge of cybersecurity to do hacking. You have to just find out a way to know the information that can be exploited. And in some cases, if you are not confident, you can give somebody some money in Bitcoin or some cryptocurrency, and they will do it for you. So I'll show you some examples. So this is a 2012 data in Forbes. And in this data, they are showing that in the dark web black market, this was the cost at that time for exploits for these various types of software. So you know that when you, those of you who you are, who of you are using Adobe Reader for reading PDF file, you often find that Adobe is sending a patch. It's saying a new version, new update is available. If you don't patch, then most probably you are having a security hole in your software. Same thing with Android. If Android sends you an update, if you don't accept it, you probably are living with a security hole. Same thing with Microsoft Word and so on. And how to exploit these security holes? You don't need to really know yourself. You have to buy a payload, what you call exploits, and then you can actually use them directly. And this was the prevailing cost back in 2012. And this is still true with the newer versions of new security holes. And even when you update any of this to the latest update, even then you will probably have some security holes. And once a security hole is discovered, there are two types of hackers, actually three types. One is a black hat hacker. They actually use the information when they find a security hole in any system, they use it to make money. They are basically doing something criminal and they are called black hat hackers. And then white hat hackers are the guys who actually tell the organization or the vendor that your software has this vulnerability. Here is how you have to recreate that vulnerability and you should plug it and ship a patch. So white hat hackers often get bugs bounty from these companies. So the companies pay them depending on the severity of the bug they discover. And then there is a gray hat who actually do, you know, both kind of things. So so if any of the you know, security holes is discovered by a black hat hacker, most probably it will be you know, commercialized and in the dark web, and people can buy this exploit and send you know, specially crafted Adobe PDF file or Word file or other kinds of malware to your machine, and then that machine was will be designed to exploit and do other things on your machine, use your machine as a launching pad for other attacks, various kinds of things. The other thing is the marketplace for owned machines. So there are groups, especially, you know, many times these are Russian and Eastern European groups who actually have infiltrated millions of computers and smartphones around the world with what we call botnet. So bots are basically special type of malware that gets into your system by you actually downloading some wrong software, or you downloading a video that is that has malware, or you might be actually clicking on a phishing link, and that link will actually go to a site which will download something for without me asking you, and those malware, they are called bots because they themselves don't do anything harmful on your system. They communicate to a backend server or set of backend servers called command and control servers, and they actually wait for commands for them. And those servers are controlled by these hacking groups. And then when somebody pays them money, they actually instruct the command and control server to use their bots. And there may be millions of bots sitting, and they can do various kinds of attacks like denial of service attacks, spam attacks, and all kinds of attacks that can be done with the bots. And so there are groups in the dark web which will advertise that I have bots, I have so many bots, and if you want a service for pay me in Bitcoin or something, and I will do the attack for you. And this basically was 2011. One set of researchers, they went to the dark web and pretended to be buyers, and they actually found that at that time the cost was about $100 to $180 per 1,000 machines. So if you want to employ 1,000 machines for your attack, then it was that cheap. And in Asia at that time the cost was less, but now I think that given that Asia has more importance, it might have gone quite a bit sharply gone up. So having said that, having scared you enough that hacking is easy and you might be victims, so let me see what are the things that you should do in order to take care of yourself. The first thing is the password hygiene, right? So we nowadays have to log into many different websites, very different accounts at work, for e-commerce sites and various things, and we often reuse password, right? So reuse of the password in two places is a very dangerous idea, because if one place gets hacked, then the hackers get that password and try to use it on your other account in other sites, and this is called as credential stuffing attack. So you, if you want to avoid being credential stuffed, then you should actually have always two different sites, two different passwords, and they should not be, you know, simple variants of each other. So you can actually use a password manager software like 1Password or LastPass, etc., these ones will actually, you have to have only a single password to open this software, and this software will keep track of all your other passwords. In fact, they will generate passwords when you need. They will generate very random passwords for you. So every time you want to log into the other accounts, you only use the password for this password manager. You open the password manager and then get the password that for a specific site. So you have a whole list, a database of the sites and the username passwords, and you can use that. And you have to have a very long password. So something like "Who took my elephant to water" is better password than something that looks like this, which seems like a good password, but it is much more difficult to guess this one than this one and brute force this one. And then do not string together pop cultural references like "Dilwale Dulhani Le Jayenge" is not a good password. If the site forces you to have special characters, you should use them spaced throughout the password. You should not say, Dolly 1, 2, 3, right? That should not be all special characters, numbers, they should be spaced throughout the password. And if you have a strong and long and personalized memory-based password, you should not change them frequently. Now, this is something contrary to what we are told by many sites. They actually force you to change your password every year or every 6 months and so on. But actually, it has been shown by Microsoft Research that if people change their password, good password, frequently, they tend to actually do a small variant of their last password. So the whole point of changing password is that you are going to be hacked because your password may get leaked if it remains your password for a long time. But if the automated programs, if they know one password, they will try various tricks to actually guess your password. For example, if you change it in only two places, and if they know your old password, they can easily, by trial and error, they will easily find the other password. And if somebody has a hash of your password, then it is even easier to guess your password using something like a rainbow attack or dictionary attack. And never reuse the same password twice. Do not trust your browser to remember your password. So we often, for convenience, let the browser remember the password. So every time we log in, we don't have to remember it. But it's much better to use your password manager to remember your password than your browser. Because if somebody comes and sits on your computer, they can log into your account if you let the browser remember your password. Whereas the password manager cannot do that because password manager needs a strong password to enter the password manager. And then if the site offers you to have a two-factor authentication like Facebook does, Google does, then certainly use a two-factor authentication for your login into any site, because that is much more secure than a single factor like just password. Now, the other issue is that people might snoop into your communication like your SMS, and this might actually lead to confidential information being leaked, especially something like an OTP or some kind of a password that you're sending to your friend for sharing something. All these things using SMS or some other non-encrypted mechanism is not good. And this is especially important if you're a journalist and you have some secret sources for information and you want to communicate with them, you certainly should need fully encrypted. Now, the encryption needs to be end-to-end encryption, right? So end-to-end encryption means that your both ends will only be able to decrypt it. There is no intermediary, no server in the middle that can actually decrypt it, right? So WhatsApp is actually an end-to-end encrypted system, but the most recommended one by cryptographers and specialists is that Signal. So Signal is an app on Android that you can use for end-to-end encrypted communication. Signal has also a feature that it will delete your older conversation. So you can actually, you don't have to personally delete them. You can delete the older conversation. So if somebody gets hold your hold of your phone, they may not be able to see what you communicated earlier. And you can set the time frame for which it will retain a conversation or it will automatically remove it. So Signal does not log any metadata. So that's the problem with WhatsApp. It logs some metadata. And Signal has been recommended by cryptographers, Edward Snowden, all these people. And Signal warns you when other party's unique key changes. So if the other party's unique key changes, then you should actually, if you're suspicious that somebody has done a SIM fraud, that is somebody has somehow gotten a SIM in the same number, and there is a whole a criminal world which does this SIM fraud for taking over your phone number without you knowing. So then that kind of thing can be actually, you can call the person and check whether the other side is still the same person. There are other messaging apps like Wire, Threema, Weaker, which also provides anonymity. It is anonymous in the sense that Signal at least requires your phone number. In this case, these apps don't need your phone number. They actually can provide more anonymity than even Signal. iMessage, WhatsApp, Facebook secret conversation. These are all end-to-end encryption, but they don't provide guarantee of collecting metadata. So they will, who communicated with who will be collected by WhatsApp, Facebook, etc. So whereas in Signal or this Wire and etc., you will not be even they will not be even collecting any kind of metadata. Now, all video conferencing tools like this Zoom, for example, we are using is not an end-to-end encrypted video conference. It actually goes to a server, and this server could be anywhere in the world. And what happens is that I am speaking to you, and that conversation, that video, all these things are going to the server in an encrypted form. But at the server, it gets decrypted, and then it gets re-encrypted and sent to you. Right, so we are not doing an end-to-end encryption. The server has all the information. So that is something that you have to remember, that if you are discussing something very secret, like business secret or government secret, or having a confidential communication, you cannot use this video conferencing tools like Zoom. WebEx has an enterprise version which claims to have an end-to-end encryption. But other than that, none of the other video conferencing software has end-to-end encryption, especially in a conference mode. Now, Signal's voice and video chat are end-to-end encrypted, but that's a one-to-one video. That cannot be a conference like this. And Wire provides a multi-way end-to-end encrypted voice call, but it's not a video call. So you have to remember that if you want to keep your discussions secret, and you don't want anybody to even know that you were communicating, forget about what was discussed in the communication, then you should not be using any of the video conferencing tools. And you should be very worried about using WhatsApp and Facebook secret conversation, iMessage, etc. You should go for something like Signal. Securing your email. So sometimes you want to send email to your colleague such that all the email is end-to-end encrypted, right? So let's say you are discussing you are sharing an IP, you want to patent something and you want to share an IP with your lawyer. So one old method that used to be that you use a PGP encryption, pretty good privacy encryption. And then, therefore, you have to by yourself encrypt the files, and then you send the encrypted file in an encoded form through regular email. But ProtonMail is a mail service that provides end-to-end encryption, provided that both parties in the email are on ProtonMail. If the other party is not on ProtonMail, it's no longer an end-to-end encryption. So there are other solutions provided. Both sides use the same software. For example, Enigmail integrates with Thunderbird email client. But again, the other side also should have Enigmail. If the other side is using a different system, it will not be end-to-end encrypted. MailVelop is also something that gives a plugin. It's a browser plugin. So browser plugin is something that you should not be using. But in case you use browser plugin, you can encrypt your Gmail. But the other side also has to have that same browser plugin. So, but nowadays, since most of the messages we share or files we share are actually quite small, so therefore, through Signal, you can send files, you can send video, you can send audio, and they are end-to-end encrypted. So you may not want to use email at all to share something that is that you want to keep secret. Now, the other problem that we often do is that we actually sit in a cafe or sit in an airport or railway station, and we connect to the Wi-Fi that is provided for free or for a small amount of money. Now, this Wi-Fi is actually nothing goes encrypted on that Wi-Fi. And the Wi-Fi, if the Wi-Fi provider is malicious, they can capture all the packets that are going through and reconstruct all your discussion, conversation, whatever. Of course, if you're using Signal over such a Wi-Fi, then they will not be able to do anything because your signal communication will be automatically encrypted over that wireless. But any other communication that you do over that network, emails, etc., they will all be easily recoverable by the wireless provider. So therefore, you should always use a VPN server. So if you are a frequent traveler, and if you want to use various kinds of communication, various accessing various file systems, accessing your home computer through remote desktop, etc., then what you should do is that you should use a VPN service. So a VPN service, what it does is that it provides you a server, and then it is on the client on your machine or on your smartphone will actually establish an encrypted tunnel between your machine to the server. And then anything that you do on the after that, once you have established that, will be actually sent to that server. And that server will, on behalf of you, will be sending stuff out to the real world, to the internet. So therefore, the Wi-Fi provider will never be able to see what you are sending, who you are communicating with, etc., because they will see only that you are communicating with a VPN server. Now, VPN service does not log your communication, who you are communicating with, and this kind of metadata, unless they are compelled to. So if depending on where the VPN service is located, depending on the IT laws in that country, various kinds of situations can happen. So VPN server actually can see who you are communicating with, your whole browsing history, your communication history, etc. So you have to make sure you read the terms and conditions of the VPN service provider. If the VPN service provider says we don't log, then also you should see that whether they have been independently audited by some company to see whether they really keep their logs or not. So it turns out that ExpressVPN is a Virgin Island based server where the IT laws don't require them to keep any logs. And they also have been independently audited for checking whether they keep logs and so on. And they cost you about 550 rupees a month. Another one that is easier to use is TunnelBear, and this is also independently audited, but these servers are in the US and Canada, and therefore their laws will require that some logging, etc., if available, should be turned over to the authorities. And NordVPN is another one, which has Panama based servers, so you can use some of these, and there are many other offerings, but you have to be careful about the VPN services. Sometimes somebody might give you free VPN service, but they might be actually working on behalf of hackers, and they actually would be unencrypting your communication on their end, and then read everything that you're using, and you have to be very careful about what VPN you choose. You should certainly do your research before you choose a VPN. Now, phishing is another thing that can happen to you if you if you're not careful. So you often will get emails saying that your account has expired. Now you should go to this link and type in your username and password to restore your account. They will say that you have this your email quota has reached its limit, so you have to go and log in to figure out this thing, how to extend your quota. All these things are phishing emails. And phishing actually often happens through Messenger, through SMS, through WhatsApp, through even Facebook, etc. So anytime you get a link or a video or a PDF file or a document or anything that you are not expecting, you certainly should not download it or click on the link, right? Because that is most probably a phishing who is trying to make you log in to a place where either you will be downloading some malware by as soon as you visit them, or you are going to actually have to type in your username password. For example, it may look like your bank, and you might type in your username and password to go into your bank, or you maybe it will look like your PayPal account. You will type in your username and password, and they will get your username and password and quickly use it before you actually realize what you have done. So first thing is that you should have your systems patched to the latest patch. So whenever Android tells you, iOS tells you, or Windows tells you that, or any kind of software that you use tells you that there is a latest update available, you should immediately download and patch it. Because otherwise there are security holes that will be exploited when you get phished. And then you should also protect all your accounts with multi-factor authentication, especially banking and other kind of transactional accounts, because otherwise somebody will get into your account by using phishing. And another thing that nowadays is happening is the ransomware. So a lot of the times we get phished and then we can download a ransomware. Ransomware is a special kind of malware that will encrypt your entire disk, and then you cannot work on your computer, you cannot access your files until you give them money in Bitcoin or some other cryptocurrency. So that's why it's called a ransomware. They ask for ransom. And most recently it has happened that governments like German city government, New Orleans government in the US, Baltimore city government in the US, and various city governments in the US have been victims of ransomware. So what that means is the whole government system gets ransomed, and then you cannot work your hospital system, your municipal system, your tax system, everything gets blocked. And until you pay to the hackers using Bitcoin and or something, they won't unlock you unless you have kept a backup system. So if you have all your data, etc., in backup, and you are prepared to ignore the ransomware attack and restart your system from the backup itself, then you can actually very easily get out of this. And that's why protect your data by taking daily backup is very important. And then sometimes, these phishing emails may come from some source like your friend or your colleague, right? Because their account got hacked and the phishing malware is now using their account to send phishing emails to others. So if you're suspicious, always ask your friend, call your friend or somebody before you download or click on a link that came from him, because you may never know that this is a phishing email or not. And then another thing that you must do is that you should check if your email addresses and passwords have been hacked by going to this website called haveibeenpwned.com. So if you go to haveibeenpwned.com and type in your various emails, your Gmail, your Yahoo Mail, your work mail, and it will tell you whether your account has been part of a large hack, that is, let's say LinkedIn got hacked several years ago, then everybody's LinkedIn account and their account email address, their password, etc., got leaked, and they appeared in a database somewhere. So then hackers can go and use that to get into your LinkedIn account and then know your contacts and then start sending your contacts in your name phishing emails, right? So you have to always be aware that which of your emails have already been hacked. And that doesn't mean that, like, if your name appears in one of these databases, doesn't mean that your current accounts have been hacked or current account passwords have been leaked. It means that some time ago, somewhere in some service where you used your email address as a username and your password of that was different from your real password, your password in your work or at your Gmail, etc., that has been hacked, right? So, for example, if you go to, Netflix and you use your Gmail address as your username and some password that is different from your Gmail password, then if Netflix gets hacked, then Netflix database gets hacked, then your email address is gone, and that email address will show up in this Have I Been Pwned website, but your password is different there, so your password is still safe. But in any case, if you find that you have been on that list, Have I Been Pwned list, then you should change your password and take care of your strength of your password, etc., for all your accounts. And as I said, that the phishing comes through SMS, WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger, email, and many other things. And then they have various kinds of messaging, fake invoice, asking you to confirm some personal information, you're eligible to register for a government refund, all that stuff. So, and then it may come from your trusted friends and colleagues. Sometimes you would get on your Facebook some private message from a friend which says, I didn't know you appear in this video, but it's very nice or something. That video itself is a malware. And if you click on that, then what will happen is that all your contacts will also get the same message from you. So your friends may think that it is from you, so they might click and then it will go to all their friends. So this is the kind of things that are happening all the time through various forms of phishing. So I have already mentioned that you have to have backup. Not only you should have a daily backup, you should also, especially if you're doing research or if you're writing term paper, you're doing any kind of programming for your large project, etc., then you should always take your hard disk backup, and the disk should be detachable from your computer. So after taking backup, you should detach the disk, because if your machine gets ransomware, then the ransomware, if your disk is connected to your machine, then your machine, your backup will also be encrypted. So then having a backup will keep backup and then detach the next day. Again, you take backup and detach the disk. So you should get a hard disk for yourself, or if the data is small, you can use an USB, but you should detach it immediately after you take the backup. And backup only things that are important, you cannot recreate easily. You don't need to backup your entire operating system or something. You need to backup your data. Now, encrypt the disk and then detach. So there are programs like TrueCrypt, AxeCrypt, StorageCrypt, etc., which you can use to encrypt the disk. So in case you want to even be more careful, you may want to first encrypt the disk and then detach, right? So because if you have encrypted it, then nobody can tamper with or attach the disk to their computer and read all your files, right? So it's better to encrypt the disk and then do the when you back up. So now, how do we keep our smartphone secure? So first of all, you should always do locking enabled. The locking with pattern is very unsafe. So don't use pattern-based unlocking. Normally, you should use fingerprint or face scan. But fingerprint and face scan can also be faked by a determined attacker. For example, they can lift your fingerprint from a surface, and then they can create a 3D print from that to use your fingerprint. So the best is to have a numerical PIN that is hard to guess. And the numerical pin that is hard to guess should not be related to birthdays and addresses and phone numbers, etc., of your friends, relatives, etc. It should be really random. So the entropy of the number, that entropy of the string of numbers should be very high. And then always stay patched. That is, and the first make that gets patched is the Google Pixel. So Google Pixel is a gets the Android patch before any other make of the phone. Especially if you're going for a very cheap Android phone, like of Chinese make or something, then it is unlikely that you will be patched within like few, it might take few months before you get patched. So therefore, you will be running an Android version that has been found to have various kinds of vulnerabilities, and that is very very scary. So if you are going to do something, if you are very serious about your privacy and security, then you should have something like a Google Pixel. You should never download an APK file from a third-party application store. You should always use Google Play and App Store. Even though Google Play and App Store does automated testing of scanning of all the software that goes there, they often miss malware-laced apps. And sometimes later on you will read in the news that Google Play has banned 300 different apps because they were having some kind of a backdoor or some kind of a malware quality, but they missed it in the beginning. So having it downloaded from Google Play or App Store is not a foolproof guarantee that you will not download something bad, but you should certainly not get APK from any third party app store, because there they don't even check even the preliminary checks that Google or Apple would do. But on the other hand, the best thing is that if you're very serious about your security and privacy, if you do banking from your phone, then you should be very worried about downloading anything on your phone. So unless the app that you want to download is essential and it has good reviews outside the Google Play Store reviews, because Google Play Store reviews are often faked by the company that put out the app. So therefore you have to do your research before you download an app. And you should always be very careful about the permissions that are sought by an app, because apps in Android, they actually ask for permissions to access your contacts, your email or your SMS or your phone, or microphone or your camera. So you should think very carefully that whether the functionality of the app has something to do with the use of the camera. If not, then you should not give permission to access, because what that means is that this particular app has a bad intention. So any app that requests more permission than would normally be required for an app with that functionality should certainly not be downloaded. And then periodically review the app's permissions by going through the settings of the phone and think carefully whether the permissions that has been taken by that app are appropriate for the functionality of the app. Communicating across computers, unlike smartphone, there are many, like on phone we use, as I said, that you can use something like Signal, but if you are doing communicating securely from computer to computer, there are several software that are known to be end-to-end encrypted, like Keybase, Semaphone, Wire, Wicker Pro, etc. Ricochet is also another one that uses Tor service. Tor is the onion routing service. It provides anonymity and privacy. Apple FaceTime, strangely, also is an end-to-end encrypted communication application across computers, but there is no guarantee of Apple not collecting metadata. But that is not as problematic as having your entire communication being logged in Apple's server and things like that. So you might want to keep your data storage encrypted on your machine, so that somebody cannot log into remotely get into your machine and get your files, especially if you are worried about intellectual property or other your tax information, your financially sensitive information, your password files, etc. So you can use various software for encrypting your file system. So VeraCrypt, Mac Disk Utility also does it for Mac. Windows BitLocker is good. And then FireVault on Mac is also good. So strongest protection is when the computer is turned off, because then, you know, there is nobody can get in. And therefore, because when the computer is turned on, even if your file system is encrypted, some of the keys and information may be in the memory. So if somebody attacks the memory, there are many attacks by in which the memory is attacked by putting a rogue process in your system, and the process basically somehow does various tricks to actually read what's in your cache, for example, and steal keys. So therefore, there is that possibility when the computer is turned on. Especially right after you have done the encryption, you should not you should turn off the computer or you should restart the computer so that the memory is parched. Smartphones provide a full disk encryption. So when the smartphone is locked, it is supposed to be encrypted. So if you are worried about the information on your smartphone disk, which is usually a flash drive, if you are worried about that, you should not use biometric unlocking. You should use strong PIN, as I said before, that strong PIN is better than biometric unlocking, because biometric unlocking has been known to be fakeable. So if you want to share large files, so suppose you are discussing intellectual property, or you are discussing sharing a large software that you are collaboratively developing. So using Google Drive, OneDrive, Dropbox, etc. is not safe, because there is no end-to-end encryption. So what you can do there is that you encrypt it yourself, and then you put it on that Dropbox or Google Drive, etc. And then tell your collaborator that this is the password to unlock it. But that is very inconvenient, because your friend now has to know the password over phone or something in order to unencrypt it. So Firefox Send actually uses an end-to-end encryption for file sharing. So you can probably try that Firefox Send. That is the better way to do sharing of large files. If you want your browsing history to be private, so some people think that if I use incognito mode, or if I use a Firefox private browsing, or Edge's in private mode, I am actually privately browsing. And that is totally a misunderstanding. All these things give you is that anybody who actually shares a computer with you, like your child or somebody, they would not be able to see, if you do incognito mode, they won't be able to see browsing history. That's the only privacy you can get. But your internet service provider can actually see everything, where you are going, which site you are going to, etc. And that's what you should be more worried about than your spouse or your child to see your browsing history. So therefore, if you are really worried about privacy and anonymous browsing, then you must use Tor browser. The Tor browser actually uses an US Navy developed routing. It's an onion routing protocol. And then even the website that you're visiting cannot find out your IP address. They only will see the terminal Tor node as the place where it is coming from. And the intercommunication is encrypted. So, and this is actually multi-layer encryption. So this is very secure and very private. You can also use Tor over VPN, so that your IP cannot be even seen by the Tor nodes. So this is something that if you're looking for privacy of browsing from prying eyes, then you should certainly use privacy preserving browser like Tor. Now, keeping your home router secure. So, first of all, you should certainly, so one of the biggest problem we found is that people buy a home router, like a Wi-Fi router, D-Link, etc. And then they come and open it, connect it, and then they start broadcasting, and then they will just minimal configuration and then start using it. But you must make sure that you change your factory username and password. So normally the factory username and password is known to everybody, admin password, etc. So if you use factory password, then anybody who is sitting in a car next to your house will be able to get into your router, change its configuration, change its DNS cache, and then it can attack you to when you do banking, etc. So therefore, first thing you should do after you get into connect your router, to electric outlet and to the to your internet jack, then you basically first thing you do is to change the admin and administration password. Then you should configure it to use at least WP2 security. So every device will require a password to connect. You must change the password regularly and use a strong password. So password for accessing the router setting should be very, very strong. You must update the router firmware regularly, because router firmwares often are found to have vulnerabilities and it has to be patched, otherwise somebody can attack you. Now, most modern routers, they actually allow you to configure so that firmware is updated automatically when they are available. So you must go into the console and check whether there is an pending update or not. Disable any remote access, universal plug and play, and WPS, because these are usually not needed in a regular home scenario. And then you should create a guest network. So you can create multiple channels, multiple Wi-Fi networks from the same router. So you should certainly have a guest one. The reason why you should have a guest one is that when otherwise, if somebody comes to your house and asks for a Wi-Fi password, you have to give them. And then you never know how it may get leaked from them or by mistake or something. So you should have your own Wi-Fi channel, SSID, which you should not broadcast. So you should tell the router not to broadcast your SSID. Only you should know, or you or your family, immediate family should know what that SSID is. So when you want to connect, you will be able to connect with password. But the guest network can be actually visible. It may be broadcast, and then it should have a password. And guest network cannot access the settings of your router. So it's most modern routers design the guest network to have very few privileges. So therefore, you should have a guest network always there. And then you should always keep all the devices that are connected to your Wi-Fi also up to date. So because a vulnerability in one device connected to a Wi-Fi can actually compromise the entire Wi-Fi and thereby compromise the other devices on your network. And if a device does not need a Wi-Fi access, you must disable it. So the final words, so these are some of the aspects. We could not cover everything, and everything that you need to know, you have to study a lot yourself. If anytime you're worried about security and privacy, you should, there are a lot of material on the internet. You can go in and look for, what is the best possible thing to do, etc. So cybersecurity is a very vast field. And every aspect of our lives are at stake today, like our personal life and data, our identity. Identity theft is a big problem. Our communication, people might be looking into your communication, including the government. And then our infrastructure, like power, water, transportation, etc. And overall, with the digitalization of the world and with excessive use of computers, smartphone, communication, apps, all this stuff, our mental peace regarding our security, especially our financial security, is currently at a very strange place. So So in this talk, we only address the issue of personal security. Infrastructure attacks are done usually by nation states, and normally it requires a response from the government and governmental organizations, as well as large utility companies like power companies. So therefore, it does not really touch normal citizens. It touches us, like those who of us who are doing research in this field. But in general, it does not touch you and in general general population. So the idea is that, you know, for cybersecurity, we should keep ourselves secure first, and then help other people, including elderly people at home who are using smartphone, who are using Paytm or banking on their phone, etc., to help them to be secure. So that's all I have. Now I would be happy to take questions. Is there any questions? Hello?
Hello. Hello. Sir, Guru sir will be joining you soon, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Are there any questions?
Sir, it was very useful session, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, we have a few questions.
Okay.
I request the participants, those who have any questions, please put in the chat window. So the first question is, can we use the strong password which gets enabled in some sites when we enter with username, or it is secure to use it?
So the question is that if you have a password and the site basically automatically fills it in, is that what the question is? I didn't understand.
Yes, sir.
No. So that's what I said, that you should not allow the browser to remember your password. You should use a password vault, like 1Pass or LastPass, etc., so that you can actually hide your entire database of passwords for various sites and use that, used to cut and paste from that database to your site. If your browser remembers your password, then anybody who sits on your computer by any chance can actually access your sites. So if you're sure that nobody else has any chance of sitting on your computer, then you can use this. But nowadays, Chrome and others also have this feature that anywhere you go and use Chrome and identify yourself as a Google, with your Google ID, then Chrome will actually remember passwords even from across the other computers. That is, I think, pretty dangerous, and that should not be enabled. But again, one thing I want to say is that security is not an absolute thing. It is actually a trade-off between convenience, performance, and security, right? So you have to assess the risk of something happening, and depending on that, you take risk. For example, if you consider security and privacy very seriously, you should not be part of the social network. You should not be putting stuff in the on your Facebook or Twitter, etc. But we do that. We actually take the risk because we want to also become, have some convenience of knowing friends, being in touch with friends, and so on. So your decision whether to do something or not, unless it is absolutely insecure, should be based on the fact that you should evaluate the risk, and evaluate based on the evaluation, you should check whether you can take the risk. So if you think nobody else uses your computer ever, then you can record all that stuff, and you can still have that. So So you can have the browser store the password. But if you think that somebody can come and use it, your machine, especially somebody untrusted, then you should not be using it. So that you have to check, make the trade-off based on the risk analysis.
So the second question is, how to know the sites are phishing websites?
How to know?
Oh, the sites are phishing sites. Websites are phishing sites.
So that's by ourselves, it's very difficult to know, except that sometimes, you know, there are you have to look at the URL. If the site is like sbionline.com, but you look at the B or you look at the I and see that there is a variant, most probably it's a fish. I mean, most probably it's actually a phishing site. So there are various ways people actually do a very closely looking name from a real, real website. So in those things, but normally what happens is that Microsoft Symantec, they actually collect a lot of information on phishing websites and they publish list. So normally if your organization should subscribe to that list, from Microsoft or from Symantec or from Kaspersky, McAfee, etc., and then actually block those sites from your at your firewall, so nobody gets victim to those, at least the known sites. But obviously attackers will always come up with a new site that Symantec, Microsoft, etc. doesn't know about. But normally the system administrator of your organization, if he's serious about security and protecting people in its network, then they normally block certain sites as phishing websites. And this list often gets gets updated all the time by Microsoft and others. So that is one way to do that.
So the next question is automation helpful for data security?
So what kind of automation depends on that. So there are a lot of automation that we do for security itself, like scanning various kinds of, the easiest one to see is that antivirus is an automation of scanning your file system and in-memory files, etc. So that is an automation that can help. But on the other hand, if you are doing random automation of workplace, for example, then you are enhancing your security surface. You are enhancing your attack surface. So what that means is that more automation means more computerization, more communication over the network. So you have to worry about more security issues because your places to attack becomes more. So if you're talking about that kind of automation, the automation certainly comes with more security challenges, and the person who is in charge of this automation, etc., has to be very aware of security and of that infrastructure that is put in place for automation. But if you're talking about automation to actually provide security, then yes, there are a lot of automated tools, including malware analysis tools, including automation of scanning for security compliance. All this kind of automations helps us to actually keep our system secure.
So we'll take up two more questions, sir, because we have a lot of questions.
Yes.
So for others, other participants, will share the mail ID of the resource person or Sandeep Shukla, sir. You can put your questions or you can ask your queries. So one more question is, a lot of software that we use today are open source softwares. So the source code is accessible to everyone. So is this a vulnerability of free and open source softwares? If no, how?
No. So I think that open source is better than closed source in security, because open source is also looked at by a lot of security enthusiasts and security researchers who are well-intentioned. So they actually look at the software very carefully, push them through various tools like vulnerability detection tools. So I think that open source software is more secure than closed source software, because closed source software means that either the company that is doing closed source software has to be extremely good in security, like Apple, where Apple has much lesser vulnerability than many other products. But if you look at Microsoft, the security is a huge problem there. So I think that open source is a much better approach to security, because you have a huge set of people looking at it in from various angles. So security by obscurity is a bad strategy in security. Security should not be about obscurity. You should actually be very open about system, architecture, your software, etc., and then use the community help to actually get more security. So I think that open source is more secure than closed source.
So in the last question of the webinar, sir, kindly elaborate on cybersecurity in COVID-19.
Well, there is a huge uptick in cyber attacks recent times in COVID-19 because people are working from home. And as I said, that the working from home means, see, in the pre-COVID time, only a few people used to work from home. They used to go through the VPN connection of the company or the institute, and the VPNs, so the attack surface was much less. Now you're connecting thousands of people to your system, although through VPN, but there are a lot of paths to compromise the system, because not all the workers are equally savvy, equally aware, and also their connections at various places are not necessarily all in a very secure place. And then the VPNs by itself can have bugs. The authentication process can be bypassed. So there are various reasons why there has been an uptick in the security challenges. And I think I was reading a report a few days ago that there has been a 6,000% increase in the cyber security attacks in the last 3 months. And that itself is a big problem. Second problem is that now that everybody and their grandmother is inventing an app to track COVID, which none of them work actually for really tracking COVID, but people are downloading these apps all over the place, and that thereby exposing themselves to various kinds of attacks. So that's another problem. The third problem is that there will be an economic downturn and economic, huge problem, like worldwide. And this would mean that there will be attackers, especially from Eastern Europe and few other countries, who would try to do various kinds of schemes that they come up with to, especially in the banking sector, in the credit card sector, finance sector, to actually get money. And ransomware attacks may also increase. So I think overall, the world and all security experts, all companies are warning that cybersecurity will be a huge problem during the COVID as well as the post-COVID world, because of various factors. I just mentioned only 2-3 factors, but there are various factors why cybersecurity situation will get worse this year.
Sir, this is the end of the session, sir. Yes. Thank you so much, sir. It was absolutely fantastic session. We got a nice feedback from the participants also, sir. From the Department of Computer Science and ACM chapter of VVCE, we'll thank you personally also for making the time to give a webinar, sir. Thank you so much, sir. And participants will share the PPT for all you people. And we have shared the feedback link also. Please fill the feedback link. Thank you so much.
While giving the presentation, I found there were quite a few spelling mistakes when typing. So I would send you a fixed one.
Oh, yes, sir. Sure, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay.
Right. No problem, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your valuable time and giving your presentation wonderfully. And we all enriched with the knowledge on cybersecurity, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And also, I'll thank all the ACM team volunteers who worked for this webinar. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you all.